Tracking, alerting, protecting. This is WKYT News at 4:30.
We're tracking showers and thunderstorms moving across Kentucky. Some of those on the strong side. We'll have the very latest for you coming up.
The Fayette County Health Department is getting a response plan in place to combat the possible spread of the deadly Ebola virus. We'll have more on their plan.
Thieves in eastern Kentucky are stealing wires from power lines to sell for cash. WKYT News at 4:30 starts now.
Good afternoon, Sam, Dick, and Amber Philpott reporting. There is a possibility of severe weather in the Bluegrass this afternoon and tonight as well.
Yeah, we are already tracking hail across some parts of central Kentucky. This is actually an eyewitness video that a viewer sent to us from Frankfort. Today has been declared a first alert severe weather day. We begin with WKYT meteorologist Jim Caldwell tracking the storm threat for us on the First Alert Defender. Hi, Jim.
And there is plenty to track out there, guys. We're tracking numerous thunderstorms and a few warnings now stretching across parts of Kentucky, all the way back out into western Kentucky now. That's how far this line goes, all the way back. We'll first get you up to date on the warning situation because we have two different warnings. You've got one warning that includes Boyle, Casey, Garrett, Lincoln, and counties, all included in on that, in Marion County as well. That goes through 450. This particular storm possibly can produce winds up to 60 miles per hour, and the big issue that we're watching, large hail, maybe ping pong ball sized hail. Think about that for a second. That is some pretty large hail. And then Marion and Taylor, at least on the back end, also included in a separate warning that runs through 450 as well. So two different warnings out for the folks there in Marion County. You got one toward the west and one that includes a little more toward the eastern sections as well. So very active also with a lot of lightning showing up. We move just a little more toward the north, and you can see the folks now in Richmond getting hit hard with some pretty heavy rain. And just to the south there of Nicholasville, all of that rain passing through there a little while ago, calming down some, at least for now. Even here in Lexington, a little quieter as we've gone through the past little bit here. Still watching this zone, this particular area, for a possible severe thunderstorm watch as we progress through the rest of the evening. You're seeing some thunderstorms just out to our west develop and fire up, and they're going to continue to track toward us as we go through the rest of the evening. Some of those might be on the strong or severe side as well, and the heavy rain threat. That's something we're tracking in our 7-day forecast. I'll have much more on this coming up for you in just a few minutes.
Jim, thank you. Today, health officials met in Lexington to go over plans in case of an outbreak of the Ebola virus in our area.
It's important to remember that there are no confirmed cases of Ebola in Kentucky, but health officials say they'll be ready if there is an outbreak of the deadly virus. Sean Moody has more on their plans in our top story at 4:30.
Well, healthcare officials here in Kentucky say no one in the state has a very high chance of catching Ebola, but they say it's important for them to stay vigilant.
Public health officials from all around came to the Lexington Fayette County Health Department to go over their plans in case Ebola ever makes an appearance here.
It was kind of to outline the systems that are already in place and to see where there may be some gaps.
Over the past few months, two people were quarantined at UK Hospital with Ebola-like symptoms, both tested negative for the disease, but doctors say they were able to learn from those cases.
We've learned a lot of lessons, not only from that, but from previous exercises that we've had and from H1N1 pandemic, and so there's a lot of things that we have learned.
They say there's little risk of anyone here in Kentucky catching Ebola and that people shouldn't be alarmed, but they also say it's important for healthcare professionals to be vigilant.
I think the likelihood is low, but I think the key for people to understand is that as long as the outbreak in West Africa is ongoing, there's going to be ongoing risk for having cases in the U.S., and we know we're more connected as a society than we've ever been.
A doctor said they'd continue to reassess their plans and make sure other healthcare professionals around the state are aware. In Lexington, Sean Moody, WKYT.
And as the Ebola outbreak continues to dominate health headlines, doctors also say it's still important to pay attention to other health risks here in Kentucky, like the upcoming flu season. A woman has died after an overnight crash in Lexington. 34-year-old Chastity Mills of Lexington died from blunt force trauma. Police say she lost control on Old Todge Road and crashed her car into a tree. Mills was taken to UK Hospital, where she died. Firefighters say wet roads and speed caused the crash.
10 show ponies died earlier this morning in a barn fire in Shelby County. That barn is in the 600 block of Ash Avenue, and fire investigators say it is a total loss. Officials don't know the cause of that fire, but there may have been lightning in the area. Show wagons and antiques were also lost.
A few hundred dollars in metal, but thousands of dollars in damage. It's the result of some thieves in eastern Kentucky thinking there's big money in power lines.
As Mitchell Grogg tells us in this Crime Tracker report, one power company says more people are trying to take copper from power lines to sell for scrap.
Kentucky Power is working to make sure its lines are protected from theft.
So they're gaining, you know, a few hundred dollars, and they're causing thousands of dollars of damage.
Police found this garden tool possibly used for cutting the copper wires. Steve Campbell of Kentucky Power says it takes years for the people who work on the lines to learn how to work with the wires safely.
Without the knowledge and the training and the personal protective equipment that is necessary to do that in a safe manner, I think it's extremely dangerous.
Campbell says one load of stolen copper wire ended up at this recycling center, which had to eat the cost when police took it.
You try to do the best you can not to buy it, and sometimes you end up with something accidentally. It's not on purpose, but you know, you just do the best you can and go on.
Manager Mark Applegate says he works to ensure he does not buy stolen goods.
We just try to follow all the state guidelines, which is get a copy of their driver's license, take a picture of the item that comes in on the scales.
Applegate says centers like this help to lower the cost of raw materials. And Campbell says that cracking down on stolen wire helps to keep energy prices down. In Perry County, Mitchell Grogg, WKYT.
Campbell says when Kentucky Power replaces lines, the company uses aluminum and not copper. Applegate said police allowed him to keep a sample of the wire they say was stolen to test it against other copper that might come in. Georgetown College is remembering a recent graduate this afternoon. She was killed in South America. The memorial for Erica Hagen is at the John L. Hill Chapel. She was found dead in her apartment in Chile last month. Investigators have arrested a security guard at that school in connection with her death. Hagen was from Marshall County and graduated from Georgetown College in May. A Powell County man wants the school district to extend the bus route to his home, saying the walk for his children is just too dangerous. Robert Barnett drives to his children's bus stop every afternoon so they don't have to walk the quarter mile home. He says there are 100 similar roads in Powell County that school buses won't travel down. Barnett has talked to school and county officials, but officials say the front of his home is just too narrow.
They can bring combines and tractors down this road. Surely to goodness they can bring a school bus down it.
Sam is at the WKYT live desk with our investigative reporter Miranda Combs with more on a story that she's working on for Six. Sam?
So, Miranda, this isn't just his problem. He says other people probably have a problem as well.
Right. There are other people on this street. Also, he did a lot of research and found 100 other roads in Powell County alone. The school bus just doesn't travel down, so he feels like it's a bigger issue than just him. Now, the judge says this is typical for any rural county, but that's not enough for him.
Is it a typical rural road where you have some homes just sort of sprinkled in various places along the road?
It is, Sam, and the bus travels down some of that road. It goes about for the 13 feet wide portion of it. It will travel, but then it stops right when it changes to 11 feet wide. And this guy's problem is you can't pass a bus on a 13-foot wide road, so what difference does it make on an 11-foot wide road?
So the school superintendent disagrees with this?
Disagrees completely. Well, he says, first of all, that road, there are some drop-offs on the side that make it difficult. Also, he says there's nowhere for the buses to turn around. He also brought up a good point that just last month in Powell County, a bus was engaged in a minor accident that basically had to do with the fact that the road was too narrow. So he's very sensitive about this topic, but they may have come to a happy medium, and we'll talk more about that at 6.
All right. Look forward to that at 6 o'clock tonight. Thank you, Miranda.